this is the focus because we have been diverting forestry in the last, you know, 20 years time, almost 1980 to 2010, almost 36,000 hectares have been diverted in the country. And you will not believe what we receive in exchange. It's a minuscule amount that we receive because we didn't have a system of reflecting the true value of benefits of forest lost on account of diversion. So that is the intent here, but what has been done is being done, but in future we should avoid these kinds of undervaluation of diverted forest land. And since last 10 years in fact we have been working. So we were part of this deep study and we follow this kind of approach of recognizing, demonstrating and capturing values. So one talks about across, because it is not just one stakeholder, huge array of stakeholders. We talk in terms of converting this into economic terms and then induce putting mechanisms which are compensation rewards mechanisms in the country. This is the kind of a policy climate. I'm just giving you a quick snapshot of these. I mean, there has been a lot of thinking because we also have been working in this area of valuation since 1989-90, and of course quite influenced by what kind of work that Bob had done, and then we also learned a number of other studies. So 88 forest policy, as I said, focused on people's participation. Another interesting thing happened in the country, which, you know, it talks more about don'ts in the system. Don't do this, don't do that, but if you don't do this, what will you give me? You know, why it's good for me for not doing something. So we had a ban on green felling, which is, the purpose was also to conserve, complete conservation in the high altitudinal states for the purpose of maintaining the watershed, the catchment, so that you get the whole area of ecosystem services in the downstream areas. That's what triggered actually valuation of ecosystem services. They were actually feeling so uncomfortable. We are all given all conditionals on us. Restrictions are being put. We have immense amount of fiscal capacities. Like if you have a resource, you can always buy and sell the resource and generate revenue. So a huge amount of fiscal capacity, but these restrictions created more disabilities than capacities. Something which is a boon for you to have resources became a bane. I can't use my resource. So for not using, there should be a system. That's why these studies have come into being. And the Himachal was the first state. There's a project by DFID and IID long back in 1999-2000. And I worked as a consultant in that project and worked out for the first time a total economic value of forest of a state. And not just we worked out, we made it a point to let people know about the value. Of course, we said that there are lots of caveats, lots of limitations, because there's double counting, there's overlapping, but still at least you have a value which makes sense. And when we made lots of presentations to policymakers, to legislators, it did make a difference. And ultimately, after 2 years of the study, they introduced an instrument called as compensation for the loss of ecological value. And when you are actually diverting forest land, giving it for some non-forestry purpose, they had a very simple formula of getting some value, which was a minuscule amount. There's a huge jump in the value of compensation. And it did make difference. Not just anybody can ask for diversion. They also became cautious in terms of asking for diversion of forest land. And when you get good amount of money, it can be used for creating forest elsewhere, compensating communities whose benefits get lost. You have some de jure and de facto kind of rights of people, they can easily be compensated that way. But you have to work out a mechanism. Then the Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation, the statistical body of the country, also commissioned a couple of studies to work out the methodology of capturing this. Then environmental policy came into being in 2006. For the first time, we had an umbrella policy. Otherwise, there were sectoral policies which were actually having cancelling effects against each other. Like industrial policy would like to have forest land, forest policy would like to conserve forest land. So how to reconcile the interest of all sectors, all systems, all in the components of the economic system? This is policy talks about, and it gave a huge support to ecosystem services, valuation, accounting, and setting up a system of payment for ecosystem services, incentive-based mechanisms. Yes, that's what we talked about. Then we also have a National Forest Commission in the country. I'm talking more about the policy climate. That's what I'm trying to say. We do have a kind of a system to effect, but we have to scientifically demonstrate these values. And that's where we are lacking the capacity to have a kind of a framework where we can work out easily these values. So we have this National Forest Commission 2006. Again, talks about, we wrote a chapter for that which got quite an amount of recognition. We worked with the Supreme Court committee to work out a value, but again it becomes a project board kind of approach. it's not possible in a given short frame of time to work out for the entire country. You can only do for a state or for a region. You cannot do for the entire country. So that's what we are given right now before I was leaving for Portland to work out a national level kind of a framework where you have different, especially for forestry sector to begin with, different forest types, if you want to do different levels, different densities, different ecological zones, different climate zones, and then you can have different, you know, calculator sort of thing to work out these values. Then we also enacted, you know, the 12th Finance Commission of India, which is the extra budgetary body, for the first time gave some additional amount for conservation. And then we did a consulting work for the 13th Finance Commission, worked out a formula based upon ecosystem services contribution, the physical parameters like density of forest, protected area network, the value of carbon sequestration, value of biodiversity, and gradually it is attaining a bit of scientific flavor, but still we have to do a lot of work in that area. Another interesting thing which I was just trying to give you a climate, a contrasting thing happened. Many people, as I said, dwellers live in forest area, and there are 100 million people which directly depend upon forest extraction for forest products. People who have been living for quite some time, they were demanding that because of your protected area network expansion, you are denying our rights, which were de facto rights since ages. So the government said there has been historical injustice being done by with these people. So they recognized their rights and awarded, you know, are giving them titles to these areas which are within the forest area. They have been cultivating in those areas, but it is the Forest Rights Act, but has a very interesting built-in mechanism of responsibilities. Incentivizing these people for not just, you know, doing cultivation, but also going for, you know, raising plantation, raising trees, and also conserving the entire habitat. It's not just, it's a clear cut land which has been given to you, you can do anything with it. This is just again intention to incentivize people to invest in their capital that they are having for purposes. And as I said, there's a National Action Plan for Climate Change. We are focusing on the Himalayan states. And another mission which came under the Action Plan for Climate Change is the Mission for Green India, which again focuses on majorly plantation outside the legally defined forest area, which is under the command of the department. But we do have urban forest, cantonment forest, and you have in many places you have agroforestry systems, so it focuses more on greening the system. And this is a kind of a response that we get from different states. This is just some paper cuttings where people are asking for the states who are conserving areas, asking for carbon credits, asking for red plus kind of mechanisms. And there has been a lot of awareness about ecosystem services, their recognition, their translation into policy, they are affecting these things on the ground. These are just, you know, we all are aware of these classification that we use in the ecosystem assessment. Very interesting thing came out of a work which Pavan Sukhdev and Haripriya had done for a TEEP study that all of us are aware of. They tried to work out the contribution of these ecosystems in the GDP of poor populations. If you just separate out GDP of poor population, their GDP is mostly extracted from natural systems. Natural ecosystems or the ecosystem. So that's what gives more focus on, more stress on conserving these ecosystems, especially the forest. And in case of India, still it is 53%. Look at Brazil, and it is very, very high if you separate out contribution of ecosystems in the livelihoods, in the, you know, daily needs of people who are so hugely dependent on that. To set up these models, we have definitely learned from US to begin with the case of the Ravana and Catskill Mountain in New York City. Yeah, when we always start, you know, understanding fears from this particular site, then the Avian Water site where the farmers were conserving the catchment are being compensated. Then of course from Brazil, the model which we are also following in the country. If you're demonstrating your conservation efforts, you are compensated in terms of extra amount of indirect taxes allocation. And then taking cue from all, we are trying to just, we have generated some studies, me plus a couple of other my seniors, Dr. Gopal Kadekodi, Kanchan Chopra, I've been doing Pushpam Kumar, I've been doing a lot of work in this area. This is the first study I talked about in Himachal Pradesh. You can just look at this site. Then we, if you just go by the conventional system of accounting, the expenditure incurred, this is an Indian currency, 109 crores, it will be around, $50 million was spent for that purpose. And you hardly generate $20 million every year out of what you invest. But when you take account of what we say, the ecosystem services which the sector provides, it went from $10 million to $23,000 annually. It's a huge increase. I wouldn't claim any precision because there has been duplication, double counting. But even if we take this value as a pinch of salt, even if you half it, it is a huge contribution. That made a difference in the state and which led to introduction of this CLEP instrument, where you have been diverting forest. And maximum amount of contribution come for the purpose of watershed benefits from this state, because they are the water towers, the catchment area. If you clear the entire area, the downstream economy is completely inundated and completely collapsed. Another, this is kind of a detail of how we capture. We did a project with Central Statistical Organization, so I was trying to just convey, we first of all thought, instead of going at a very large scale, let's develop a very simple kind of a calculator or step-wise methodology. And we said, let's first of all see what data we already have with us, instead of reinventing the wheel and starting from scratch. Lots of studies are done, lots of efforts are being made by different ministries, different organizations, different institutions, experts. Let's try to put all the beads in a string, try to understand that. So we developed a very simple methodology, which of course requires huge refinement that we are doing right now, but we just looked at the existing literature, existing data sets, and worked out, that's what I was just trying to say, the value of diversion or conservation in these states, keeping in mind the existing data, existing, you know, methodologies. So we developed a simple methodology, we tried to work out the annual benefit and also the cost. It's not, because it should not be gross value, it should be net value, subtracting cost of generating these ecosystem services. We worked out for timber, I'll give you a simple example, one example that I'll see. For example, fuel wood. We have, the Central Statistical Organization conducts surveys, sample surveys every 3 years, 5 years. And work out with the household consumption of fuel wood, fodder, and TFPs, and gives an average value for a household. And you can extrapolate that value to the entire village, to the entire region, and they work out region-wise values. So huge tables and data sets that they generate with. So we use those to work out at least some value of fuel wood, because it is being extracted for self-consumption. We should know how much is being consumed, and then we can use some, you know, surrogate pricing technique or substitution approach can be used to assign value to the amount which is being extracted. The extracted for use does not mean because you don't pay it has got zero value, that's what now the concept came into being. Similarly, we did for fodder, for grazing, for non-forest products, and of course we use IPCC guidelines, the good practices guidance to look at the carbon sequestration value. We look at ecotourism aspect in terms of people who are visiting sites for the purpose of tourism but because of forests which are existing in that region. We got data from the departments and then how we work out these values. For what biodiversity, we use the actual value approach and option value approach, which of course it needs to be further refined and need to be upscaled for the entire country. For watershed function, which is the most difficult one, as we all understand, there's so many watershed functions, not just one. So we had some studies at place in terms of forest and water connect, which we actually extrapolated to work out the value for. So, but of course, for working out these values specifically, we require specific models and more precise information, more detailed knowledge base. So we are doing it now.
Can I ask a question? Yeah. Do you prefer I wait, or can I ask a question?
Yeah, you can.
So what is the status, the conservation status of these forests? Are they protected? Are they?
Yeah, because there's a policy guideline for protection, and people are involved in conservation process. But what we have been observing, this came into being in 1988 and it was effective from 1990 onwards. But we are finding it's not just a matter of generating ecosystem services or the conservation of systems, but also aspect of efficiency, equity, distributional issues, how you actually affect the institutional mechanism. We are finding that connect to be very, very low, very bleak. And there are not enough returns available on account of conservation, which are the visible ones, which are marketed benefits of timber and non-timber forest reduce. So we want the calculus to be expanded to ecosystem services. But huge effort is to be made to, they are recognized, but they have to be valued and they have to be rewarded. We can do into some kind of actual payments to these communities.
But these are actually public forests?
These are public forests. The only state which has got private forest. The rest of the country has got governmental forest, but it is a kind of, I should say, because people are involved and we are trying to shift the model from centralized kind of to more democratic and also making it participatory. Right now it is joint forest management. There is a huge effort to convert this joint into community forest management. So it will be kind of a private, but it will be eventually the sort of, some, just as things are being leased out to 99 years or so, so you have that kind of model in this. But it will take time because things have to be structured in a very robust fashion. Otherwise, I mean, you cannot imagine sitting here the amount of population pressure that the country faces. It's huge, it's huge. Density is so high. So things have to be very strongly structured, effective on ground. And that's what we are realizing. It's beyond the control of the government to, you know, in the domain of the government to look after everything themselves. If it is community-based, you can do social auditing kind of thing. You can monitor your own things, which will be more cost-effective. And of course, it will give you amount of return. But another aspect comes into being, if these communities or committees, what we create by managing these resources, don't have enough power to bargain in the market to get these things, because transaction costs tend to be very, very high for them. They have to be collated together, and then on their behalf, things can be put in the international scenario. Like for REDD+ negotiation for carbon credits, we have only two forest carbon credits project in the country so far because of the procedural aspects and qualifying areas, land as forest land, a couple of things are there which are quite complex. But there are experts available who are helping it out, and there is a huge scope available in the future. But India argued, as you would be aware of in the international discussion process and the international platform of UNFCCC, of the compensated approach or conservation approach, because we have already conserved large areas as forest. And we have very low rates of deforestation. So need to be compensated for conservation, then for actually clearing the forest and raising new plantation and asking for carbon credits. Right. So that doesn't hold good for us. But again, we have to face this thing in the international platform that you already have a regulatory system of conserving these, you know, having 2/3 in hill areas and 1/3 in the rest of the areas. So how does it qualify for market mechanism? So we're just struggling to qualify for this, because a carbon conserved is carbon saved. You have not, otherwise you are saving it by capturing it in future. You already have captured that. So, I mean, this is quite complex. So that's what I'm quite keen to understand, the way work is being done here, so that we can more scientifically demonstrate these values to the policy makers, to the negotiators, and we'll be able to claim these benefits in future. So that's kind of, you know, thing has to come. Similarly, we worked out value for Uttarakhand forest using Bob's example for tropical forest, and again we found huge rise in value. This is an interesting example for first such model. Of course, we had two models which were initiated by the communities to work out compensation mechanisms for communities engaged in conservation. We did work with IIT UK, with DFID support, and Midrock International India. We were, a couple of other teams worked with us. And it's a micro watershed catchment where we try to work out a process of incentive-based mechanism. When the upstream area was conserved by the communities, there were three level villages, one village at the top, one at the middle, another at the lower level. And this was actually in the Himachal state again, in the Kangra catchment or area of Himachal Pradesh. And this particular site called as Bori Suma Ushkara, there were three villages actually here, and Kun catchment. And of course, we had done the whole process through a lot of consultation amongst women, other stakeholders. And you would not believe, within a few years' time, when they restricted their extraction from the upstream forest, restricted their cattle to openly graze in that area, there were a good amount of grasses available. The forest came up as a dense forest within 5-6 years' time. And then look at the amount of grasses available here. Otherwise, if the cattle are grazing openly, they even take away the saplings which are required for further replication. So they could see a connect, and not that they had water for themselves, they also had water to supply the neighboring areas. So they put up a tube well here, a small, you know, pump to pump water, and a small water market also came into view. But if you look at the economics part of it, it was done with the support of institutions who were actually researching. And we had big budget for us to work, and then. But if they have to do it independently, it will be difficult for them to execute. So we will build these capacities and work on behalf of larger communities such that they can be, their capacities can be built, they have this knowledge and it is set up mechanism. This is just one example of local, you know, water and forest kind of a connect. We have interstate issues, we have inter-country issues, where you have international payment for ecosystem services. Similarly for carbon sequestration, biodiversity, livelihoods, landscape values. But then, of course, not many things are still required to be done. And then we are realizing when, of course, the focus may be carbon or focus may be watershed conservation, but at the same time you also generate other values, what we discuss in terms of bundling of these services. But we have to find a market person who can buy these services and either bundled or individually packaged kind of services. So, but at the same time, another argument comes, especially the Himalayan state, which is an interesting argument when we say that there's a forest and water connect in these areas. But there are lots of snow-capped mountains, there are glaciers, and rivers become live because of melting of glaciers also. So require hydrological modeling to be done to prove that if you're asking for a payment from forest, the water is coming from forest. Mm-hmm. So it's not easy, you know, a lot of scientific base is required to generate these returns in the future. So that's what we would like to actually build. A project mode is fine, but how to replicate this? This is an interesting project done by Community Forestry International with a university in northeastern state of Meghalaya, where I was just talking about the highest rainfall areas are located. We also have the largest forest sacred grove in the country, in Meghalaya state. We also, you know, you would have heard about Indian traditions, customs, we worship plants, we worship animals, we worship trees, we worship rivers, they are holy for us. And we do not pollute, we do not plug, we do not extract from these sites. This is one of the largest sacred grove of forest in India. But what these countries are getting in exchange, this is conserving because of religious beliefs. And they're making immense contribution to the downstream localities because they are in the catchment area. So they worked out the value of their, you know, hydrological contribution, biodiversity. It's immensely rich in biodiversity. You can see there's some structures, this is a forest area. This is entire, this is 75 hectares, which is expanded to now 150 hectares more, and they are still adding 100,000 hectares of land because that is again conserved as, you know, forested catchment is conserved as sacred. But again, this is still on, they haven't yet received any benefit in exchange, but values have been worked out. They are being taken forward for the purpose of compensation in the international markets. There's one more thing, I'll just give you the final outcome of it. We were asked to actually do a study by the Finance Commission of India, again to demonstrate the contribution of forests in the economic system. And we worked mainly in the Himalayan states again, and used combination of, you know, economic indicators and the qualitative indicators and the area-based indicators to demonstrate these values. And ultimately, we recommended lots of formulas for them, and which is combine the contribution of ecosystem services, the density of forest that they have, vegetarian network that they have, and found that in these particular states, regulating services, which are the watershed values, carbon sequestration and all, have got much, sorry, this happened, they have much larger contribution than as compared to the provisioning services, which are the timber and non-timber forest regions. Then there's an increasing economic value of provisioning services with decreasing forest cover. Because they're getting scarce, definitely the value will go up in due course of time. We also face a typical, you can see, this is India, and these are the northeastern states I'm talking about. A typical chicken neck problem. It's very difficult to access these, you know, states. They have immense potential for providing lots of services because they've got a lot of water resources, forest, beautiful landscapes. You cannot imagine the beauty unless you visit these places. Huge frozen lakes and, you know, Buddhist monasteries, which is one of the, they have the cleanest villages in India as well, in that sense. But difficult to visit these, but you can definitely encash upon these recreational values, of course, in a sustainable manner in the future. These are the findings for us. What we are doing right now, a project we are doing with YASA, I just wanted to very quickly give you an outcome of that. We are focusing on, because carbon is one of the ecosystem services for which market to some extent is visible to us. We still have to work out on biodiversity premium and biodiversity values and a couple of others. So we thought that we are working again in two Himalayan states and one state where I'm based. Working on the India Forest Carbon Model, we're working with IASA in Austria. They are helping us out because they're the ones who work a lot in modeling systems. We say the argument here is the carbon stock that we would like to project in the international market is a function of couple of factors. There are additions to the stock, there are deletions in the stock. There's a policy climate which influences the stock, there's a ecological regime which influences the stock. In Indian context, the population pressures, values changes, a lot of competing demands come on the sector. So what we have, is it a true value? It can be more, it can be less. And we always, you know, otherwise we'll fail in our own discussions if we don't reflect the value truly. So the idea, that's what we're trying to build in. We are developing, it's a Stella kind of also model we are developing, and also a spreadsheet-based model. But again, the problem is that of data sets, you know, creating data. That's where I find the approaches that you follow here, and I think MIMES and, you know, ARIES, that you go for stakeholders consultation, generate data from the sites which are weak in data sets, and try to reflect these things. That's what is the intention here. But we are not doing that much. We are doing consultation, extracting information, but not the way that you have been doing. This is the first attempt, so we will get something in terms of output. And there's a double connect of livelihood. If you are able to maintain these stocks, you get a huge support for livelihoods. Otherwise, livelihoods actually pressurize these sectors and you degrade your stock very fast. And then ultimately, how we can give some kind of a policy interventions and set up market mechanisms when we have true value of carbon available with us. So this is the structure of, we're following the Canadian model, which broadly use this kind of a framework. These are some of our outputs that we have produced. As Josh mentioned about the regulating services guidance manual with Pushpam Kumar. This work we did for the Finance Commission, the work for Central Statistical Organization, we made other publications as well. So that is my intent of coming here, that we are working on agriculture ecosystem services right now in the state which was supposed to be the most progressive state, Punjab, in terms of agricultural output. But it also faced, you know, all these, you know, problems of degradation, loss of its fertility. And then how if you're making a transition, making a shift in terms of model of intensive inorganic to organic kind of, or integrated kind of a model, what incentives you have for people or farmers to offer. And how will you work out those incentives based upon the ecological services that the systems will generate if you maintain them as, you know, organic sites or you follow more kind of biological control mechanisms. We are working in Himachal Pradesh state again to work out the value in a much more intensive manner. So I would like to learn about it. And of course, we would like to generate enough amount of conservation environmental finance for the purpose of mitigation aspects in which have some scope, but more is for adaptation because things have changed. A simple example I'll give you in terms of shifting the altitudinal levels of apple cultivation in the Himachal state and many states which cultivate these crops. Similarly, saffron in Kashmir, and we get a white mushroom which is very famous in cuisine of India. Things are changing and they're shifting up in the upland areas, and they are ingressing into otherwise rich forest areas because apple is one of the produce through which state earns huge amount of revenue. So definitely it would happen. So how to adapt to changing scenario, go for high temperature, you know, more tropical kind of, you know, species, that kind of, you know, knowledge base is required in the country's context. And of course, in terms of people's livelihoods as well, the things change, their extraction, their dependence, their requirement, their availability also varies a lot. So these are the, you know, your works I'm very much interested in. So the Invest in National Capital Model, the project, ARIES, MIMES, and GPI, in fact, Bob is also working after having experienced here in Maryland. He's working on GPI for Oregon State. So they're very keen. This is a very good way of understanding where you stand. Indian context also, many times we are quite complacent. We are very boastful of achievements. We put a target of 8 to 9% of growth rate, but we realize we don't know where do we actually stand and we're going to achieve it or not. And what kind of cost we are paying in terms of loss of natural capital while achieving huge amount of built capital or physical capital. So I'm really very, very happy to learn about what details you have done this work on GPI, and you also have this project. So I want more from you. this is all about my work, and I'm very happy to respond to queries. Rather, looking forward if we can do something to be more capacity building for us to do something on collaboration. in future. We have good strength of students to work, and we would like to strengthen our own center for ecological services management, and that way we can contribute something for my own country.
And there's the one thing about students in India, I think the competition to get into universities is extremely high, isn't it?
Yeah. So the thing is, we have to get this knowledge base that you gather here back in the country so that we can make use of it. So we would like to that way collaborate and to strengthen our own capacity so that we can. And it's, I must tell you, it's a country which is, I mean, you will really enjoy working there, because kind of response you get for your work, because people can see a connect in the work that one is doing. It's not assuring anybody. We don't go, we always tell them you're not coming with a budget to give you. It's just to take a stock of situation and try to argue on your behalf with the government. And when we are able to make the difference, it's such a satisfying thing for a researcher also to get ultimately on the work that one does. Thank you so much for giving me time here.
You know, I think for the regulating services, which you said are very important, mm-hmm. those are the hardest ones. They tend to be public goods. They benefit people in general,
yeah.
not people specifically so much. So it's very, very hard to develop like any kind of private sector
exactly.
mechanism.
Exactly.
And
exactly.
so in India, are you actually using that you know, the intergovernmental fiscal transfer? So where
exactly.
one government pays
exactly.
another
exactly.
for.
Yeah.
And is that within states or at the federal level from okay. federal to states, or do you know? Because in Brazil, it's done within states.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering, in India, are you doing it, you know, is it like the state rewarding municipalities? I don't know what your geography or
yeah,
local breakdowns
yeah.
are, but or is it federal government rewarding state governments?
What we have, I mean, we learned from Brazilian model, of course, and then the New York and AVO model. But we also realize it is difficult to start at the municipal level and the state level when we are beginning this kind of a transfer mechanism. It was more of from central government to the state government.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's what also we realized, if we work on one-to-one state basis, like we already have lots of tribunals existing in the country, we're trying to resolve the issues of interstate water transfers, interstate, you know, migration of people from one state to another when we have nomadic people visiting. And more tribunals are addressing the issues of the river water sharing issues. And they're already been trying to resolve since ages together. So what we thought is it's better to actually recommend to the central government, because you have a common pool of resources at the central government level. A part of your state GDP goes to the central government, a tax effort, because the number of central taxes which are generated in the state but go to the central government. And there are some state taxes, part of which goes to the state central government, but most of the part remains with the state government. Larger kitties is at the central government level. So that's what we thought, let's first of all begin with the central level. And instead of having one-to-one state transfer where the negotiation will be very, very difficult to push forward, to demonstrate to them the contribution of the sector in the overall economic system. Not just contribution, because not always we convert something into a monetary value, but also it in terms of, for example, a state is having very dense forest area. Large number of areas is protected areas. In physical terms, it should be given preference over the states which may be having large area under forest, but having less dense forest area, and having less protected areas which are repository of genetic material, biodiversity, animal habitat. So we combined the economic values with the physical indicators together. Mm-hmm. And that was effective. That was, I mean, and we also did a lot of consultation, state-wise consultation, different stakeholders, and got the values from them as well, and we did our own valuation using the benefits transfer method because we were working for a number of states together. And ultimately this happened from center to state. And the state of Arunachal Pradesh, where actually the head of the state was also is also very keen that we should take up a detailed study over there to establish this PS kind of mechanism, because this is a state which from where lots of rivers originate. And they have this directive of, you know, keeping two-thirds of the area under forest and tree cover, and there's no mechanism of again giving anything in exchange to them. So when we demonstrated these values, they got a compensation of almost, how much I should say, $1,000 million. Almost, which is one-fifth of the total allocation for the entire country.
Wow.
Because they are the richest one in terms of biodiversity, highest in terms of forest and tree cover of the geographical area, 80% of the areas under forest and tree cover. So they said, but this is an ad hoc system of giving you a compensation. Why can't we set up a permanent system of receiving in exchange?
Mm-hmm.
And this free of, you know, in the, because of the directive, they have to keep such areas under forest and tree cover, they cannot do anything else. And they need funds. Everybody likes to scale up and have a better living standards. And so they had gone for tremendous number of projects, which are the multi-purpose dam kind of projects. Mm-hmm. And this is a state having very steep altitudinal slopes and a difficult terrain. And if all these dams get functional, one day the entire state will be wiped off. Not just the state, because it is in a seismic zone as well. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, they're restless. What should be done? You know, you are constrained despite having huge resources. So if this kind of process is being effected on a regular basis, to receive enough money in exchange for the developmental activities, for establishing things, for constructing roads, buildings, schools, medical and health facilities, because they're not able to generate their own revenue in requisite amount. So, but in India, this experience says that you should not go state to state right now. It is better center to state, where you have some allocation process. And because we have experienced this functioning of tribunals over the years for at least water disputes which are not able to resolve the issues. So that's why right now center to state kind of.
Yeah. Okay.